We have with us right now Mr. B.Sriram from State Bank of India. Thank you very much, sir, for speaking with us here on NDTV Profit. We are now seeing this sort of a rate war, ever since the RBI governor has cut the repo rate by about 75 basis points, all the banks have now started cutting, and there is some sort of a competition that we are also seeing. Ever since the rate cut has happened, your bank has also passed it on to the customers. Have you seen any sort of a pickup in the credit demand, because that was the prime motive while why all this was being done?
Credit demand is slowly picking up, I would say, because if you see the retail portfolio, what we did in the first 2 months of last year as compared to the last 2 months of this year, there has been quite a healthy growth of about 25-30% in the number of sanctions. So to that extent, generally the months of April and May are months which are what we call lean season for us. But despite that, in the area of home loans and auto loans, as well as in personal loans, we have found that there has been quite a good traction on that. In terms of corporate credit, it may take some more time because, rate cut is only one of the factors. There are various other issues relating to it in terms of project coming down on the ground level and trying to pick up. So corporate credit will take some more time, but it's a sign where, people with the existing capacities would probably start to look at expanding their capacities and taking the advantage of these lower rates.
When we hear from the largest public sector banks saying that the corporate pickup is going to take some time, what's your estimate? How soon can we expect a pickup coming in from the corporate sector? We were earlier hearing that we may see some green shoots in the fourth quarter of last financial year, but of course did not really happen. So what's your assessment? By when can we actually see the economy picking up pace?
There are a lot of initiatives which are being taken by the government over the last 3-4 quarters, as well as going into this year. There is of course this Make in India campaign which is going on, and they'll create a lot of interest and buzz. We have the affordable housing program which will be which will give us a lot of traction, and the other core industries will start to see a lot of traction in this, like cement or steel, because all these are related industries. My guess is that maybe a couple of more quarters, 2-3 quarters, before these credit starts to really pick up in that sense. And that's why we have kept a credit growth target of about 14-odd% for this year.
Now, you've transferred the rate twice to the customers ever since the RBI has, cut the repo rate by about 75 basis points. Is there now more scope for another rate cut for the customers? Has the cost of funds come down?
It takes time for the cost of deposits or cost of funds to try and come down. We are seeing a small impact on it. If you see our portfolio, about 40% of our portfolio in current and savings account is largely, rate agnostic. And it's only the remaining 60%, which accounts to about 8.5 lakh crores. Where the interest, when you start to price the deposit down, it starts to have some sort of impact going down. In terms of repo rate cuts, I think it's a very small portion, it's only about 1% of our NDTL, which could probably get the benefit of the repo cut. So while the trending downwards is slightly starting to happen, but with such a large portfolio and going forward in terms of incremental deposit rates, which are priced slightly lower, it will take some time more for the cost of deposits and funds to start to trend really downwards. Yeah.
So are you trying to say that probably in this particular quarter, the quantum of rate cut which was supposed to happen, it has already happened from SBI. Now we'll probably have to wait for the next quarter to start, and then we can expect another rate cut to the customers?
This quarter is just another few more days away, so I don't think about this quarter. But I think the idea is to try and see where there is a possibility of transmitting better rates to the customers at large. At times, the impact of the rate cuts for the banks is covered by the larger volumes that is expected out of the rate cuts. Mm. So we need to have a fine balance between what we are transmitting and what sort of volumes are getting built up in the credit space?
You know, the broad sense, Mr. Sriram, we get is that, you know, what the industry has been asking for, people have been asking for, is that you give us a rate cut, the interest rates are so high and hence there is no loan demand, no credit demand. Has there been any sort of a thing that you have seen coming in terms of volumes, as you're saying? Is that going to be the only factor which is going to provide volumes to banks in terms of credit demand, or there are other things also which will be important? If yes, then what?
No, it's not only a question of whether the current rate is low or high. You know, it's only the whole question revolves around as to where the interest rates are actually trending. In a home loan, for example, which is over 20, 30 years, today's buy-in at whatever rate, you know, is probably not as much applicable as it is over a period of 20 years or 30 years. So it's a long plan, a long thing. You know, if you cut the rate today, and maybe after 6 months or 1 year it goes up, you know, it doesn't make much sense. But generally, you know, the economy doing well and the, you know, the inflation under control. If and over a longer, medium to longer term, if the interest rates are trending downwards, then it's a good sign to the industry to try and enter and take the benefit of these lower rate cuts.
Mr. Sriram, also when it comes to providing credit, the sense that we got in the fourth quarter was, on one hand we had high NPAs, so the sense was that probably banks will now be focusing more on the retail credit than the corporate credit, and they would probably try and stay away from that sector. Is that going to be the trend that we are going to expect from public sector banks, or they will be more cautious in lending from here on? And if yes, and then which particular sectors, you know, are going to be the ones where you will be really cautious about?
What we have is a very healthy mix. You know, we have about 45% what we call retail, and the retail would include personal retail, agriculture, and small and medium enterprises. We have about 40-odd% in mid and large corporates, and the remaining is our international banking book. So we have a reasonably healthy mix of retail, corporate, and international banking. And I guess going forward, it's more or less a similar mix. You can't obviously outgrow corporate substantially, even if you or like to focus on retail, because the ticket sizes are quite small. But yes, with the retail reach that most of the Indian banks have, and including our bank, we have about 16,300 branches. It is very important for us to be in the retail space and try and grow that as aggressively as we can.
The way we have got this entire financial inclusion program, Jan Dhan Yojana, and now the social security schemes, do you think that's probably going to provide some bit of volume in terms of credit lending, credit demand? That's going to also bring in some sort of a thing, or that's a long term vision that we are aiming at?
These programs will have sort of what I call a triple benefit, in the sense that you see, half the work is done, half the work in terms of trying to get the customer to open an account with us and to sort of transact with us in some way, that has already been done. Now the remaining and the more challenging job starts, and in the sense that, you know, we need to get the customers to try and transact in these accounts, and that is very important for us, because just opening an account is a costly acquisition, is always costly. So unless the customer comes and transacts, and you know, with the bank, there is no way that the bank will be able to create a record of transactions and thereby create a record which will help us develop a credit portfolio for the customer. So that is very important, and we are taking enough steps for that, you know, in terms of trying to build balances, transactions in these accounts, and thereby we've already built in a credit product based on the transactions and level of balances and the turnover in these accounts. So that will be easier to spell. So that will be the second aspect in our strategy. The third one, and the main thing, is to try and do all this in a digital mode. You know, it's very difficult for us to, you know, if you have 3.5 crore Jandan accounts which have been opened, it's quite difficult to try and do these products in a manual basis, so that we don't have that sort of manpower. So the point is that we have to reach out to these customers in a digital mode, try and see who are all eligible, and then reach out to them and say that, look, you are eligible for these products, and why don't you come and take advantage of it. So that is something that also we are looking at, and I'm sure this will also give us a benefit on that. The tertiary or the secondary benefit that we have on this is all try and do the cross sell. Finally, to a large extent, the whole thing is driven on a pull factor, in the sense that the insurance premium has been kept at a lower rate to try and get people to get into the habit of
putting money in these accounts
and trying to get the benefit of these social security schemes. Mm. But the larger impact is that the people should come into the financial inclusion mode, be part of the advantages that the banking industry gives to these customers, and take a part in the whole development of the country.
How soon do you see that happening? How soon do you see that becoming a reality? And also, are we going to see now a digital sort of a movement coming in from SBI side, possibly say in FY16? You're going to be really aggressive when it comes to digitizing the whole bit?
If you've seen the last 6 months, we have been quite aggressive in the digital space, both in terms of trying to use the mobile to push through a lot of our transactions, and also we have started to collaborate and discuss with the major players in this digital space, including e-commerce players. Two or three MOUs we have already signed with Snapdeal, Amazon, and PayPal, and going forward the intention is that we should be leveraging all the possibilities that the digital world gives us. And to that extent we have a very good analytics team which is working on how we can leverage this. We have a big e-commerce team now in place, so we should be able to drive all these out, not only in terms of trying to cover the payment space, but also try and cover the full value chain that is offered by a certain corporate. For example, the e-commerce place, when we are doing it, we would like to do it from the person who delivers to the e-commerce space to the ultimate customer who receives the goods, and what sort of products that we can develop around that particular delivery that we do to all these customers. So cash on delivery is something that is very important for us. So these are some things that we are doing. What we are also doing is to try and leverage the digital space to try and push the cash business substantially lower. As you know, cash is something which is very costly and also has other implications along with it in terms of transacting in cash. So the lower that we push on cash, the costs that we have in the books will start to trend downwards as well, to the benefit of the customers.
Yesterday we heard from the government side a proposal has come in, that they are looking to reduce the transaction cost when it comes to using debit card and credit card when you're buying fuel or you're purchasing rail tickets and various other tickets. Do you think that's going to be a good move and eventually we'll move into a cashless economy?
No, that's a very good sign actually, in the sense that, as I said, the major portion of our cost is out of transacting in cash. Most of our branches actually, the amount of transactions that we do in cash is quite humongous. So to that extent, if any encouragement towards a cashless society, I would rather say first less cash society and then cashless society. This is definitely help the banks in trying to promote other products. Most of us have some sort of wallets which are there, and encouragement of wallets will obviously make small value payments much more easier than going and doing it in cash. There's also this mindset among most of us, the country that we are, that we hold some cash with us, it is a matter of comfort. We'll have to tell them that holding the mobile as well is a matter of comfort, and you can do anything with that, including transfers. Not only without even knowing your account number, I can transfer to somebody else money purely based on the mobile addresses that I have in my address book. So these are some things that should help in terms of reducing cash across as well as reducing costs across.
So that's one part. But what my question primarily was that, you know, there is a transaction cost. Of course, that must be coming to the banks, and that that accounts for the additional income or some other part of income which the bank really gets. So if there is no transaction cost, is that going to impact the income of the bank in any way? Or, you know, what will be the impact of cutting that transaction cost that you get as a banker from using a debit or a credit card?
No, in the intention in this is to try and reduce costs which would otherwise be there, and try and pass on that benefit by way of these products that we are looking at. For example, if you do a transaction in a branch, it costs you close to 50-60 rupees. And if you do it on mobile, it hardly costs you anything.
Okay.
So if I am reducing the number of footfalls in a branch, to that extent, whatever gains that I get out of it,
so that will balance it out.
I should be able to pass it on to anybody. The second part is that I can try and the same sort of the data that I have, that I captured in my system, I'll be able to analyze the data and try and sell a few more products of the bank through the same medium or mode. You know, it'll only help the bank to improve incomes in different ways.
But Mr. Sriram, on the other hand, we also have this small and payment bank, the new concept that RBI has really introduced. Now very soon we are likely to hear on the licenses as well, who all will be getting. So won't it in a way compete with your idea of, you know, trying to probably connect with the e-commerce players? Won't it be a competition for you in the near term then?
Payments bank will start to bring in, they are restricted to certain levels, in the sense that they don't do the full.
They can't take deposits. Certain restrictions.
They can take deposits, but they can't, lend. That is the idea, and they can only invest in treasury bills, and so only to that extent, you know, they have a limited space, and they have a role to play in the overall scheme of things. You know, as I said about getting to a cashless sort of society, and the advantage, and in some way we are, you know, through our banking correspondent network, we are actually driving a certain payments model across the country, in the sense that while we have 16,000 branches and 45,000 ATMs, we also have about 55,000 kiosks which are with these banking correspondents. So the idea of, there is still a lot of potential. Our country is very big, and the sort of spread that we have, the geographical, the cultural diversities and all that. So we need more and more players to try and see that the financial inclusion is across the country. The other thing is that we have to, I think, look at, as I said earlier, also look at collaboration. We need to look at collaborating with players and trying to make sure that the full array of banking products, which the payment banks obviously cannot give, is given to these to the customers at large, and try and make sure that it's a win-win for every one of us, rather than looking at competition and saying that, look, I will compete with you and I'll try and take business away from you.
But according to you, what's the way forward? We've discussed, there have been debates around it, that probably consolidation is now the way forward, considering there are so many banks where, you know, which are not really able to perform, high NPAs are there, making losses. Is consolidation a way forward now, or we need more, you know, types of probably niche banking, which will probably help the entire help in clean up of the entire banking system in the country, which is under a lot of stress right now and is a cause of concern? Rating agencies are saying if this government doesn't really fix the banking system, the ratings are going to be in trouble. There is going to be a lot of impact on the overall economy as well. So what's, according to you, the way forward? Do we need consolidation, more big banks like SBI right now, or we need fragmented small banks as well?
To me, it require a bit of both. You know, it is, we are still a country which is evolving. Banking, there's still a long way to go. We need big banks to look at big financing, and we need big banks to also drive the economy, be support to the economy in a certain way. We don't require large corporate borrowing from 45-50 banks, but we require some 4-5 banks to take care of their interests as well. At the same time, we also require what we call niche banks, specialized banks, smaller banks with greater efficiencies to take care of certain other issues that are there, or certain other requirements that are there in the economy of the country and in the banking space. So to my mind, it has to be a mix of both. The main thing here is how the banks are performing, rather than whether it is big, small, or you know, whatever it is, or niche. How the banks are performing, what is the bank's business model, and I guess going forward, the way you need to measure a bank is by way of what return the bank is going to give on capital.
Capital infusion has been another key concern. Now, we understand banks were not really happy with the method that was used last year in giving funds to various public sector banks. Is the government now considering, and what's really the need of reconsideration of the capital infusion? Because at the same time that the government has asked the banks to mobilize their own resources in their own way.
Now, that is one good lesson that we have got to the bankers, in the sense that you know capital is costly, capital is scarce, and we need to look at capital, each one of us to look at ways and means in which we use this capital in a very good way. So, and the only way to measure that, how you are using, is the return that we will probably be able to give out of the capital. And anybody, any stakeholder, whether it's the government or anybody else, would like to create, would like to invest only when there is a return to it. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I think there is also, as we say, that we need to also look into our business models and try and make sure and convince the government, look, this is a very healthy and going forward a robust business model that I have, and this is what is my plan, and I'm sure we need to also make sure that the person who's giving capital, I need to convince him that I will make full use of the capital, and that is how I think we should be able to get capital for us.
But in the month of March, government very clearly had said that banks should mobilize their own resources. They should use different ways to raise capital. Is SBI considering that option as well? Apart from asking, we understand every bank is making a presentation. They have to make it by 3rd of July. So are you considering other options as well, apart from asking for more funds from the government side?
No, capital raising is an ongoing exercise, and it addresses all stakeholders who are there. Now, all our capital raising plans are already on there in the public space, and we have got all the approvals to even go and raise capital outside the government space. We will take a call as and when we feel that we need to raise capital. But yes, it's an ongoing process, and we continuously keep looking at any opportunity which will give us a better valuation and try and give us.
In total, how much is the capital requirement for this year that SBI has?
No, at the moment we haven't. If you see the ratios, we are quite comfortable in 9% and 12%, which is the board mandated Tier 1 and overall capital requirements. So at the moment we are above that.
Okay.
So there is no requirement as of now for to satisfy certain requirements.
Last topic probably that I wanted to discuss is also NPA, which has been a big concern. Now, a lot is being said about it. RBI is also coming out with a lot of ways and means that probably banks can help clean up their balance sheets in terms of bad loans. What is SBI doing at this point in time, over and above what was being done earlier, to reduce the number of bad loans in the system?
We are doing a lot. See, each and every account that is stressed, and from the point stress, meaning I'm saying that anything that is overdue by even a day, at various levels, depending on the size of the exposure that we have to the particular unit, at various levels we have certain committees which are going and trying to make sure that it is recognized early, the stress, and we try and see whether we can how we can address that issue. That is in terms of stress accounts which are there. Mm-hmm. In terms of NPA accounts, you would have seen that we have taken issues like such as the mega auctions that we are conducting. Mm-hmm. We are also looking at, we have done the OTSs for the agricultural tractor portfolio. Mm-hmm. We have done ARC sales. We have gone and expedited certain cases which are there in DRTs and all. So all in all, there has been right across the board, there has been substantial concern and also urgency in trying to address this portfolio where, you know, obviously we can't sit with the NPAs on our books for long. So that is something that we have started to address. And as a result of that, you would have found that, you know, in the NPAs have started to trend down. If you see the last quarter, we have gross NPAs has come down substantially to 4.25% and net NPAs to about 2.12%, which has been a very good improvement over the previous quarters. What we are today looking at is trying to put in our processes to make sure that we don't create NPAs for the future. You know, we have a there are different types of processes in terms of trying to see whether our underwriting process is robust enough. We are also seeing as to whether some of our products can move towards the risk mitigated aspect, and to that extent the ABLs, the asset backed loans, the EDFS, this electronic dealer finance schemes, and some schemes which are self mitigating and brings a lot of cash flows into the accounts on its own. So those sort of things are being put through. We also have a, I've introduced a early warning signal system in the bank, right? So that, you know, at the time when it's a dynamic system which measures each and every larger corporate of 5 crores and above and gives early warning signals much ahead of time so that any steps that may be needed to address the situation is taken by the bank much earlier than what is required to be done. So all in all, and I think the some of the steps that the RBI has also come out with has helped us in moving forward quite a few of our NPA accounts in a very satisfactory way.
So can we expect probably a below 3% number when it comes to your gross NPA in the current quarter? Can it be around that one?
Now we are doing our best, and a quarter on quarter, I would imagine that we should be bettering. If you compare the Q1 of last year to Q1 of this year, I think we should be each and every quarter. If you see over the last 4 or 5 quarters, you will
it's
find
been
that
trending downwards.
Even in, not only in terms of the NPAs, but also in terms of the slippages. It has. We have started to look at slippages in a extremely focused way, and we are. I'm sure. Going forward, the effort should be like that.
What's your target for FY16 as far as NPA is concerned? Any number that you're targeting?
We are targeting to go down by at least 15% to 20%, but we will wait and see how it goes.
All right, Mr. Sriram. Thank you very much for talking to us here on NDTV Profit.
Thank you. All the best.
Thank you.